40. Okay. There you go. Enjoy the show.
Get the change.
Okay.
Exactly.
I don't know where I'm going to sit.
There's plenty of seats without tables in that back row.
Just got the
thank you. Thank you very much for coming. We're here to talk about something we treasure, freedom of speech. Everybody's going to be doing it this year with the celebrations of the Bill of Rights anniversary and the usual court fights and the public squabbles. This talk isn't about that. It's an appreciation of free speech. We find the thing fascinating. It's not just the best part of America. It is America. It's not just what we have. It's what we are. Ridiculous, heroic, generous, dangerous, hilarious. A country built out of words. A country built out of free words. It came to me by way of my father, this appreciation of free speech. My father didn't like free speech. He did his best to keep me from it. I loved and I admired my father very much, but he was a very severe man, very brusque. He had a list of unusual maxims and aphorisms by which he lived, in which I assume he intended I do the same. One such maxim was, never trust a Hungarian. Another was, nothing worthwhile ever came out of Brooklyn. Now, at the age of 3 or so, it was rather difficult for me to live by these rules, but he issued them anyway. He also used to say, in a pig's eye, you will. I suppose that was sort of a maxim. And for sheer variety, he would say nothing worthwhile ever came out of the Bronx. Oh, I understand, by the way, that Geraldo Rivera is not without his own geographic tastes. In his autobiography, Exposing Myself, Geraldo writes, aesthetically speaking, growing up on Long Island sucked. If you have nothing to do one evening, see if you can discover the syntax of that sentence. All through my growing up, my father and I had fierce political fights. He had nothing but contempt for my liberal politics, contempt he was never shy to heap. One night we were watching the late news, our identical red armchairs angled toward the television screen, when George Wallace came on, George Wallace, then the governor of Alabama. This was in Wallace's heyday of race baiting, before he got shot and became a national treasure. In those days, Wallace stood for all the conventions of bigotry, and that evening he was, as usual, fully and freely speaking his mind as my father and I watched. Oh, I neglected to mention, in these fights with my father, I was always in the right. Generous, humane, kind, fair-minded. But my father always got the upper hand. So there we were, watching Wallace prattle on about the inferiority of the Negro, and my father and I seated in our customary, companionable, stony silence. When, after what seemed like decades, Wallace finally stopped. My father waited just the right beat. Then he drawled, you know, in a decent world, a jackass like that wouldn't be given 2 seconds on television. But thanks to you liberals, he can talk his brains out. It was one of 2 major lessons I had about free speech. The second occurred when I was a teaching fellow at Harvard, and one afternoon I was grading papers when a lawyer from Boston phoned. He said, Professor. Now, as you know, a teaching fellow is the lowest order of being in a university, perhaps anywhere. So anybody who says Professor is off to an excellent start. Professor, he said, I represent a movie that a judge is threatening to ban in Boston. We need someone to come down and testify that the movie has redeeming social value. We would like you to come down, watch the movie, and so testify. Said, thanks anyway. I was busy grading papers. I didn't have time to go see a dirty movie in Boston. He said, but you believe in the First Amendment, don't you? I said, I do. I just don't have time to go see a dirty movie in Boston. He said, we can pay you $500. I asked him where the movie was playing. Called my wife, Ginny. Said, Ginny, want to go see a dirty movie in Boston? Sure, she said, sure. Didn't ask who was calling, just said sure. So the next scene has the two of us alone in a darkened theater in the middle of the afternoon, seated beneath the shadows of the fake royal boxes, our noses twitching with the combined smells of popcorn and Kit Kat. Ginny looking as eager as a puppy in a pet shop. I with a yellow pad of paper in my hand, prepared to take notes in the dark. The movie was The Devil in Miss Jones. No, it was not Long Dong Silver, whatever that is. All through the Clarence Thomas hearings, I kept imagining the producers of Long Dong Silver jumping up and down for joy every time the movie was mentioned. Artie, I told you we'd have a hit. I told you we'd have a hit. Anyway, The Devil and Miss Jones began, as all such movies do, with the numbers rolling down, 9876. As soon as the first frame appears, it is already the dirtiest thing I've ever seen. Nonetheless, I dutifully set out to find redeeming social value in the thing and compare The Devil and Miss Jones to great works of art. I felt proud of my ingenuity and thinking of the 500 bucks I was about to make, patriotic as well. So I sat and I watched and I took note after note, making esoteric analogies of The Devil and Miss Jones to Shakespeare and Rembrandt and Mozart. The dildo and banana scene I compared to Dante. When the lights were on, our eyes were squinting, Ginny looked gaga, like someone who had been sitting on the inside of a steamship whistle when it went off. I, for my part, was heaving with scholarly enthusiasm. All of which went out the window when the Boston lawyer phoned again. Professor, he said. His voice was melancholy. I did not perk up. Professor, forget it. It's all off. But why, I asked. I found lots of redeeming social value. He said, it makes no difference. The judge decided to see the movie for himself, called it the dirtiest thing he'd ever seen, and banned it in Boston forever. Hesitantly, I said, I suppose my $500, but by then the lawyer had hung up, leaving me with the same lesson I had culled from that experience with my father, to wit, free speech is a lot easier to defend if no one hears it. Nonetheless, we defend it wholeheartedly. We celebrate it. That's what this talk is, a celebration of free speech. A celebration of free speech as an instrument of revelation. That's my thesis. Free speech is an instrument of revelation. Sometimes it reveals us as wonderful, sometimes as considerably less than that. If you watch those Clarence Thomas hearings, you know exactly what I mean. But the basic element of free speech is that it is expansive, eternally expansive, like the widening beam of a searchlight. And what free speech reveals with its widening beam is us. So the title of the talk is Free Speech in America. Free Speech in America, or Ashley Montana Goes Ashore in the Caicos. I shall explain the subtitle eventually. For those of you taking notes, the talk is divided among the following sections: free speech in culture, free speech in politics, free speech and the development of character, free speech in fun, and of course, Ashley Montana Goes Ashore in the Caicos. Don't be concerned if you forget these sections. I tend to repeat myself, and we have several visual aids. For the moment, see this with me in your mind's eye. Survey the country in your mind's eye. Every morning, America awakens fully prepared to say whatever it's on its mind. The new day lies open like a river, and we are ready to ride it with all the words at our disposal. Every word is an idea, and ideas go to make up our being. So we are prepared to fill every day with ourselves. This morning, this very morning, the presidents of the American automobile companies returned from Japan, looked in the mirror and said, you know, maybe we should build a better car. Nah. And the lawyer Alan Dershowitz awakened and stared into his mirror and thought that he would rewrite the trial, the play about the Scopes Monkey Trial in Tennessee, in which he would play Clarence Darrow, and the play would be retitled Inherit the Chutzpah. And Pat Buchanan awakened in New Hampshire and stared into his mirror and said, Al Sharpton is running for the Senate. I'm running for president. Is this a great country or what? And Senator Strom Thurmond awakened and stared into his mirror and said, why? And the Council on Foreign Relations awakened and looked into their mirrors and wondered how to explain to the American public that the situation in the Soviet Union was at once desperately tragic, yet immensely hopeful, yet complex. And Oliver North stared into his mirror and wondered if it would be possible for one more day to disguise the fact from the American people that he is crazy as a loon. And Lee Iacocca looked into his mirror and wondered if there was anything sufficiently jingoistic and self-aggrandizing left to say. And the voters of Louisiana continued to look into their mirrors and said, woo! All except David Duke, of course, who said, ah. And Senator Strom Thurmond continued to look into his mirror and said, why? All these people, millions of them, millions, Alan Alda, Alan Bloom, Bruce Wasserstein, Bruce Springsteen, Don King, Don Imus, Don Mattingly, Don Gotti, just kidding, Regis and Kathy Lee, Elizabeth and Lawrence Taylor. I can wait. Jesse and Latoya Jackson, and Latoya's spokesperson, and Latoya Snake, MC Hammer, O.J. Simpson, E.L. Doctorow, Club Med, the Hair Club for Men, Cy Sperling, he's not just the president, he's a client, and Vanna, and Oprah, and Prince, and the people who came up with the name Nobody Beats the Wiz, and the people who say, no problem, and the people who say, enjoy, and the people who say, film noir, and you, and I, and they, pimps, snitches, saints, media advisors, baseball psychologists, camcorder salesman, the people who buy the Chia Pet, the people who run model airplanes on the sidewalk and say, check it out, the people who come up with those clever names for delicatessens such as Locks Around the Clock or Kosher Nostra, chanteuses, masseuses, chocolatiers. Everyone awakening to morning in America, fully prepared to say whatever is on their minds, and by their words we shall know them as they know us by our words. It's a gift. Free speech is a gift. I quote Madonna on this subject. I quote Madonna whenever possible. I know you do too. And Madonna put the matter perfectly in the lyrics of a rap song. Dr. King, Malcolm X, freedom of speech is as good as sex. When Madonna says that, I listen. We turn first to free speech and culture. And by culture, I mean culture defined at its widest. So widely defined as to include journalism, if you see what I mean, and advertising. Advertising, too, is part of the culture. I'm interested in culture as it affects and addresses the largest number of people, mass culture. Remember our thesis, free speech is an instrument of revelation. And what free speech seems to reveal about our culture is that our culture is very strange. Indeed, it seems to make our culture strange. I don't know why this should be so, why freedom should lead to strangeness. It just seems to. The strangeness of our culture often shows up in the things people do not want us to see. That Boston judge who banned The Devil and Miss Jones was almost as revealing as the movie. Censorship itself is a revealing form of free speech. The people who want to ban certain books from our children, to keep our children from reading books, are absolutely free to explain why. I enjoy these explanations. Some people in charge of our nation's school libraries would like to see to it that our children do not read Macbeth, King Lear, or The Great Gatsby. They don't want our kids to read Macbeth, they say, because Macbeth, they say, promotes witchcraft. Now, you and I don't ordinarily think of Macbeth as promoting things, but if it promoted anything, I suppose witchcraft would be it. They don't want our kids to read King Lear either. I suppose it promotes ingratitude. The Great Gatsby. Long Island? Sometimes the reasons offered for censoring certain works are obscure, thus intriguing. In Spokane, Washington, they wanted to remove the children's book Where's Waldo from the shelves. They wanted to remove Where's Waldo, they said, because the book contains, quote, explicit subject matter. A plea for surrealism, I suppose. In Springfield, Virginia, they banned a book called Hitler's Hang-Ups because it offered, quote, explicit sexual details about Hitler's life. You know, given the other tendencies of Hitler's life, you'd think the sexual details would be relatively acceptable. Still, it sets one's imagination to churning Hitler's hang-ups. Oh, no, you don't, my little Führer, says Eva Braun. Not with that, you don't. And the title is excellent, Hitler's Hang-ups. My friends at Time magazine and I used to have a special shelf on which we collected books we most admired, the titles, our favorites, real titles of books that came in every year. Office favorites included God and Vitamins, Socialism for the Dead, my own personal favorite, 1637, A Year of No Significance. And the absolute favorite of the boys in the office, a computer book called Using Your Wang for Business. Even if you want to make up a music book titles, authors and editors will beat you to it. I saw a book the other day on the life of Liberace called Beyond the Candelabra. You cannot do better than that. I wish the new novelist Ivana Trump were to get married again soon. She deserves happiness after the Donald. I would like Ivana to marry the ascetic Supreme Court Justice David Souter, just so that Mr. Souter could write a book. Too much, too late. Finally, to return to book censorship in the town of Astoria, Oregon, a book called Wait Till Helen Comes was challenged in an elementary school for giving, quote, a morbid portrayal of death. A morbid portrayal. I hate it when books do that. But it's all very odd, isn't it? Freedom leading to the creation of such strange stuff, such as advertising. If free speech did not exist, there would be no advertising as we know it. Think of that. No advertising. Nothing to fill the gap between greed and death. If there were no advertising, we would not know advertisers. We would not know products. Most of all, we would not know what advertisers think about us. I think they think we are more glamorous than we are, but also very strange. There's an unusual TV ad for a product called Safe Ears. You may have seen this, Safe Ears. A woman steps forward to advertise gold-looking earrings with secret compartments that contain condoms inside. Condoms hidden in the earrings. Most inventive. The world has come a long way from the Roy Rogers bullet ring I had as a boy. With its secret compartment, which contained nothing, I assure you. The woman says that safe ears are fabulous and fun. Fun. Have you noticed the odd way the word fun is used these days? A man works 20 years on a dictionary of Zoroastrianism. Asked how the project went, he said it was fun. It was a lot of fun. An actor appears in a one-man play, Pol Pot Tonight. It's fun. It's a lot of fun. Several weeks ago, we were treated to John Sununu's letter of resignation to George Bush. Among other oddities, Mr. Sununu mentioned how much fun it was working in the Bush White House. Now, when you and I imagine life in the Bush White House, several words pop to mind. But fun is not the first of these. What could fun consist of in the Bush White House? Bungee jumping with Brent Scowcroft. C. Boyden Gray locked in the Lambada with Margaret Tutwiler. Let's party. The product is called Safe Ears. Safe Ears. Imprecise use of language. It's not the ears that are safe. At least I hope not. And they sell three to a set. Three earrings to a set. You'd think if your date were so constructed as to be able to wear three earrings, safe sex would be the least of her concerns. One of the reasons I like the Christmas season so much is at this season on television they advertise a product called the Clapper. Some of you may have seen this one. The Clapper is a marvelous device that allows us to turn electrical appliances on or off merely by clapping our hands twice. We can turn anything on or off, a waffle iron, a computer, merely by clapping our hands twice. You know what they say about inventions? Find something the world really needs. Still, the clapper is not for every situation. I picture a man awaiting electrocution in the electric chair. The warden rushes in. It's a reprieve, Smith. You're free. Smith says, all right. Let us give credit where it is due, however. On the morning after Mr. Sununu's resignation, there appeared this full-page ad in the New York Times from Virgin Atlantic Airlines. Repeated the headline, Sununu resigns under fire, and then it added a message to its customers as well as to Mr. Sununu. Just a reminder, you can still get a free limo from Virgin. That's very nice, very thoughtful. A little different from the ad for Virgin Atlantic Airlines that I saw on the side of a bus this past summer, which read, if you want to be number one, don't treat your passengers like number two. They told me a high-toned audience like yourselves wouldn't like toilet jokes, but I defended you. Release is a word of advertising. Here, a strange idea is contained in a single word, release. Someone's always releasing something, releasing a perfume, releasing a line of cosmetics, releasing a line of cosmetics. I picture mobs of lipsticks and facial creams surging against a restraining rope. Suddenly, Jacqueline Smith steps forward to release them. Cher has released her own perfume. Whoosh. I would like to release my own perfume, my own parfum purum, like Egoist, or Calvin Klein's Obsession, Roger Rosenblatt's Depression. Am I depressing you? Are you depressing me? Or are we both entirely incomprehensible? There seems to be a deliberate effort on the part of all this strangeness to avoid the normalities of life. Maybe the makers of our culture seek to repudiate the normalities of life. Thus, they create all this exceptional material. Free speech is an instrument of revelation. I don't mean to sound superior. Journalism is surely no better than anything else. Journalism, too, reveals a strange trade and a strange America. Bizarre, in fact. Everyone hates us journalists. In a national poll, we rank second among the most despised people in the country. First are US congressmen. It must be true. U.S. congressmen are the only people interested in talking to journalists. I've never really fit in the profession. I lack the necessary gravity and devotion to the news. I'm always bringing humiliations upon myself. In the 1970s, I wrote a column for the Washington Post. One morning, I was in the men's room standing at the urinal, urinating, fortunately, when the managing editor, Howard Simons, joined me. Well, not exactly joined me. He occupied the urinal adjacent to mine. Howard was a magnificent, no-nonsense man with a capacious heart. He died a few years ago, thus breaking everyone else's heart. But that morning he was, as usual, fully and deeply absorbed in the important world news when I called to him across the urinal divide. Howard, I said, Howard, about to give voice to the question that had been deeply troubling me all morning, Howard, why is the letter N silent in the word column, but is pronounced in the word columnist? Howard sighed, zipping up. Roger, he said, I wish I had your problems. It wasn't my worst humiliation in the trade. One year we were living in Vermont, and I got a call from Ray Cave, the great editor of Time, asking if I wanted to write essays for Time magazine. I did, very much. I just didn't want to look it, didn't want to look overeager, didn't want to look like a hick, especially in front of Cave, who looked like Rockwell Kent's portrait of Captain Ahab, the square-cut beard, very dour manner, very severe. Yet when I drove down to New York, everything went fine. Conversation went well. The hours were fine. The assignment was fine. The salary was fine. In those days, any salary would have been fine. $50, okay? Fine, fine. But I wanted to show him I had something, that I had some gumption. So I said, well, my voice cracking because I was about to tell a lie. I said, well, I'm used to 4 weeks vacation. Now, this was both true and not true. At the Washington Post, where I had worked under Howard Simons, I had 3 weeks vacation. But in a university where I saw the devil in Miss Jones, I had 3 months vacation, so I figured the whole thing averaged out. Well, I'm used to 4 weeks vacation. I looked at Cave. Cave looked at me. I could tell, he could tell, he wasn't dealing with any corn-fed, any rube. I could tell he could sense my power. All right, Roger, he said, after a pause. We ordinarily start with 5 weeks. But in your case, we'll make an exception. My ineptitude aside, I still cherish journalism as the main vehicle for free speech. It can at times be brilliant. A few years ago, Liz Smith, in a TV gossip column, suddenly announced, "We have just learned that as a boy, Klaus von Bülow served as the ring bearer in the wedding of Hermann Göring." Then she waited just the right Jack Benny pause. "I know it's boring," said Liz, "but we get so few social notes from the Third Reich these days." All journalism emphasizes strangeness, thus the culture it creates is strange. I saw this extraordinary item on our own NBC local news. A man in Florida was suing a doctor for a faulty penile implant. The man claimed that the implant made his penis explode. That's what the reporter said. Man was given an exploding penis. Make a nice novelty gift for the life of the party, wouldn't it? Oh, good, here's Harry. People denigrate the tabloids, but the tabloids are not far removed from that NBC story. I think, in fact, that journalism is often best revealed in the tabloids because the tabloids, by their excesses, reveal the essential characteristics of the trade. Like the so-called respectable media, the tabloids, too, emphasize the extraordinary over the ordinary. Journalism is primarily interested in life when it is strange. It is a weakness of the trade. Among the tabloids, I especially admire the Weekly World News, published in Canada, of all places. One recent issue had more illuminating items in it than the Washington Post and the New York Times combined. The lead story was entitled, "Horse Born with Human Face." Horse born with human face. Doesn't look much like a human face. Then again, doesn't look much like a horse. And nowhere in the article does it say how this biological miracle occurred. Just as well. But my favorite part is the subhead. He's as smart as a whip. Another article in the same issue is entitled, "Baby Flies Out of Mom's Womb at 50 Miles an Hour." And the subhead to that one, "Tiny Rocketeer Miraculously Lands on Stretcher 12 Feet Away." Tiny Rocketeer, isn't that great? Where are you going to get writing like that? The very best article in the same issue is entitled, "Gay Elephant is Cured by Porno Flick." Cured. The article went on, a swishy 6,000-pound elephant named Izzy loved to rub tusks with the boys, but thumbed his nose at the gals till a sex therapist taught the pansy pachyderm. Till a sex therapist taught the pansy pachyderm. Isn't that terrific? The joys of making hay with the ladies. See if you can read that in Cuba. When we come to television, we see a world revealed that is the strangest yet. Free speech is an instrument of revelation. Television, like books, advertising, and journalism, also reveals itself as favoring the strange and bizarre. Yet it treats the bizarre as normal. It calls itself a global village. It is a village none of us has inhabited. I suppose that's why I like television so much. I find it educational. Without television, I never would have learned of the existence of Zamfir, master of the pan flute. There's a TV ad for Zamfir showing the titles of beloved songs, scrolling down, Autumn Leaves, Unchained Melody, that sort of thing. While a man makes a low, melodious moan on an instrument that looks like a small, dry pizza and sounds like the background music to movies starring Ruth Roman and Van Heflin. Until television, I confess, I had never heard of Zomfir. Or the pan flute, if it comes to that. I assuredly did not know that Zomfir was master of the pan flute. So you ask yourself, or I ask myself, is there an annual pan flute competition? A pan flute Olympics to determine the master? I picture all of Zomfir's eager competitors lined up, all these pan flutists, flautists, flaunting their pan flutes, each of them eager to play the beloved theme from Elvira Madigan, or the beloved theme from Love Story, chafing at the bit to unseat Zomfir and ruin his highly competitive life. Silence in the stadium as the old man steps forward. You could hear a reed drop. And then, with one sublime rendition of Que Sera Sera, the championship is back where it belongs. Zomfir, master of the pan flute. Makes me happy to think about that. I also like the Sunday morning news analysis shows. Not the McLaughlin Group. That's too intellectually demanding for me. Too deep. But I'm crazy about the David Brinkley Show. I love it especially when Mr. Brinkley makes those penetrating sardonic remarks for which he is celebrated, such as, thank you, or variously, thank you very much. The people Mr. Brinkley are thanking are the experts, like Alexander Haig, who come on to explain everything. Henry Kissinger and Alexander Haig, still in charge. And Jean Kirkpatrick, the godmother of soul. I feel good. I feel satisfactory. And Zbigniew Brzezinski. Zbigniew Brzezinski. Zbig. Movie trailer. A small boy makes a wish to grow up all at once so that he might become a former national security advisor and earn a solid living making wildly inaccurate political predictions. Yes, it's Tom Hanks in Zbig. And James Baker and Dick Darman and Bill Bennett. I was interested when Mr. Bennett resigned as drug czar last year, declaring his tenure a total success. That was a relief. For a moment there, I was sure we'd never get rid of that drug problem. All these experts speaking our minds for us so we don't need to do it ourselves. What luck. And John Sununu, of course. John Sununu, the frequent flyer. In spite of his demotion, Mr. Sununu is still known as the brains of the outfit in the Bush administration. The brains of the outfit. Reminds me of the Marx Brothers movie Room Service, in which Groucho is always introducing Harpo as the brains of the outfit. Then Groucho adds, that'll give you an idea of the outfit. The most entertaining television, though, and the most fanciful as well, is late night television. I mean really late night. After you've been asleep for a couple of hours, and you wake up, and you've concluded the self-recrimination period, and it's 3:19 on the digital clock. My favorite time, prime time. It's an underworld, a netherworld. I lie there in the dark, my face a fetching blue from the reflection of the screen, holding the remote control device in my hand, clicking my way into free speech's most mysterious kingdom. Click. There's Dave Del Dotto's cash flow system. Live from Hawaii. A get-rich-quick scheme based on real estate. It's live from Hawaii. People wear leis. John Davidson is the host. He calls upon Dave Del Dotto, who in turn calls upon people to testify how rich they got on his real estate cash flow system. A man from Texas steps forward to testify that he made $50,000 in the first month. The crowd goes wild. They go wild at the mention of any dollar amount. $100, $4, it makes no difference. You see, Dave Del Dotto's get-rich-quick real estate cash flow system works like this. You buy real estate from someone at a low price. And you sell it to someone else at a higher price. Click. I watch an all-women's bowling tournament from Duluth. Duck pins. It's a repeat. Click. I watched C-SPAN's all-day coverage of the Department of Agriculture. The soybean hearings. Click. There's Sally Struthers for the Christian Children's Fund. Haven't seen Sally since All in the Family. The Christian Children's Fund. It's not the worst of these charities. The ones that get to me are the ones that say, for a few pennies a week, you will have a foster child, and your foster child will write you a letter every month. Your foster child will write you a letter every month. I haven't received 5 letters from our 3 children in their entire lifetimes. And here my foster child, on whom I've never laid eyes, is going to be forced to write me a letter every month. Better get writing, do. He'll cut you off without a dung. Horrifying, horrifying. Click. I watch a grainy black and white movie in no known language. Click. I watch a documentary on the career of Walter Cronkite as a documentary host. The host is Walter Cronkite. Click. Chips, a rerun. Click The Bionic Woman, a rerun. Click The A-Team in Spanish. It is now 5:23 on the digital clock. Time to watch Xanadu. They only show the movie Xanadu between 4 and 6 a.m. I have never seen the whole thing. Every time I tune in, there's Olivia Newton-John on roller skates singing, Xanadu, Xanadu. Maybe that's all there is. Click. I tune into the Weather Channel. It's temperate in Bombay. Excellent. Click. I tune into the Shopping Channel. I am tempted to buy everything. A woman's heart pendant for $99. A woman's silver-studded pants set. Pants set. 2 legs. I'm growing woozy. I tune into the Joe Franklin Show. Joe seems to be celebrating his 200th birthday. His guests are Amelia Earhart and Judge Crater. And St. Francis of Assisi. St. Francis wants to interview Bill Moyers so they can nod their heads at each other for an hour. But Bill is too busy interviewing Robert Bly, the author of Iron John, who in turn is trying to persuade Charles Manson to discover his wild man. I'm growing delirious. I think I see George Plimpton in an ad for Stay Free MaxiPads. Hi, I'm George Plimpton for Stay Free MaxiPads. I see an episode of Fantasy Island in which Ricardo Montalban is falling in love with Tattoo. Don't touch me, boss. I see a new quiz show, Senator Alan Simpson's What's My Mind? I see a new culture show, Norman Mailer's Book Beat, in which Norman beats up everyone who doesn't like his books. Show scheduled to run a long time. But I'm growing drowsy. I lie my head on the pillow, soon to fall asleep, and dream of the First Amendment and all my lucky stars. Let's go to free speech and politics. And I'd like to relate free speech and politics to our last 5 presidents. You know why I'm doing this, of course. Because we have just entered a new presidential election year. So I thought you'd like to look at our last 5 presidents. Yes, it's less than a year in which we will be voting for somebody like one of these 5. Does your heart beat faster? My heart beats faster. I studied the list of the New Hampshire primary candidates, found a man named Paul Fisher. He's running. He's described as a manufacturer of ballpoint pens. He has my vote. Harold Stassen is also on the list. I could have sworn that Harold Stassen is dead. Not that that should disqualify him. But think about these last 5 for a moment with me, will you? After all, they represent our last standards, our most recent standards for the presidency. Nearly a quarter century of United States presidents. I admit to some confusion. You see, I've lived half a century. And in half a century of living, you think you would have met all the types of guys there are to meet. All the types of fellas there are to meet in half a century of living. But in half a century of living, I have not met anyone remotely like any of these 5 fellas. Maybe Jerry Ford. I have met a couple of nice regular guys like Jerry Ford. But Gerald Ford was not elected. He was not carefully chosen out of 200 million citizens to be the leader of the free world. These other guys, well, I've never met anyone like them. Maybe that's how they got elected. They're different. What interests me specifically about them, of course, in terms of our thesis, is how each of them speaks or spoke. Remember, our thesis, free speech is an instrument of revelation. Whenever any of these presidents opens his mouth, he reveals exactly who or what he is. No one forces them to speak the way they do. They come by it naturally. It's what makes listening to them so instructive. Let us begin in chronological order with Mr. Nixon. Here is Mr. Nixon making his first visit to the Great Wall of China. He turns to then Secretary of State William Rogers and says, "I think you would have to agree, Mr. Secretary, that this is a great wall." Here's Mr. Nixon on a state visit to the funeral of President Pompidou. He comes for the funeral, he arrives in Paris for the funeral, steps out of his limousine, looks about and says, "It's a great day for France." I've always held the theory that Mr. Nixon was meant to be a great comedian. And only by a perverse diversion of fate was he changed from his proper course. I interviewed him a couple of times. The first time I put my tape recorder beside him, he looked at it momentarily and said, "Oh, that's one of those new tape recorders. They're so much better than the old tape recorders." I didn't know if he was joking. I did not laugh. I did not say, "Oh, yes, Mr. President, these don't skip a minute." I did not say that. But if you want to appreciate Mr. Nixon's genius with language, if you want to see the true Nixon revealed by free speech, study his ability to use free speech for deflecting blame. Not merely deflecting blame, but casting it upon others, especially if they happen to be dead. In an interview with David Frost some years ago, Mr. Nixon finally gave his full, candid explanation of Watergate. In a single paragraph, he managed to establish his analytical ability, his managerial efficiency, his sympathy for others, and the total guilt and insanity of former Attorney General John Mitchell's wife, Martha, who was, of course, dead. Let me read this to you. "I'm convinced." I know I'm no good at this. It just gives me pleasure to do it. "I'm convinced that if it hadn't been for Martha Mitchell, and God rest her soul, because she is, in her heart, was a good person, she just had a mental and emotional problem no one ever knew about. If it hadn't been for Martha, there'd have been no Watergate, because John wasn't minding that store. He was letting Magruder and all these kids, these nuts, run the thing. Now, am I saying here that Watergate should be blamed on Martha Mitchell? Of course not. I'm trying to explain my feelings of compassion for my friend John Mitchell." Remember such passages, friends. We will never see his like again. And to give Mr. Nixon his due, he never concealed his intentions with free speech. It was he, you remember, who also said, "When the president does it, that means it's not illegal." I'm going to skip over the presidency of Gerald Ford. I hope you will pardon me. I say the line every night, I don't care. I'm going to skip over the presidency of Gerald Ford because I could only find one memorable thing he said. I suppose it was revealing in a minor way. Like Mr. Nixon, Mr. Ford, too, revealed himself through free speech, but benignly, as a good-hearted bumbler. Asked if he still followed baseball, Mr. Ford said, "I always watch the Detroit Tigers on radio when I can." I like the "when I can." To be fair, lots of politicians make slips of the tongue like that. When the cops broke up the demonstrations at the 1968 Democratic Convention in Chicago, Mayor Daley put everyone at ease by explaining, "The policeman is not there to create disorder. The policeman is there to preserve disorder." During Vietnam, a senator from Nebraska made an impassioned speech on the floor of the Senate in which he referred throughout to Indigo China. You have to be in the mood for such a speech. Even Woodrow Wilson said, if enough people are out of work, unemployment results. For similar misstatements, Mr. Ford may be forgiven, and they reveal, after all, only a certain awkwardness. But when we come to Jimmy Carter, free speech reveals a little more. Like every free speaker, Mr. Carter was revealed by what he said, even when he said it wrong, perhaps especially when he said it wrong. His oddest misstatement was probably not his fault, any more than the killer rabbit was his fault, if you remember that incident. Still, the remark made history. It was said when he was in Warsaw, and he wanted to express his warm feelings toward the people of Poland. Whatever it is he said in Polish came out translated as, I have lust in my heart for the people of Poland. Or variously, I want to make love to all the Polish people. Now, Mr. Carter was often talking about lust in his heart, so it is remotely possible that some odd passions were cooking in his oven. Still, we may chalk this up to a mistake. Where a slip of the tongue is more seriously revealing, however, true feelings may emerge through the slip. For all his genuine good deeds since leaving office, and there have been such genuine good deeds, Mr. Carter in office often seemed kind of petty, bogged down in details, and he could get a little mean. Free speech sometimes revealed Mr. Carter as small. Everybody knew that Carter thought that Hubert Humphrey was a windbag. It was not a total surprise then at the 1980 Democratic Convention in New York when Mr. Carter referred to Hubert Horatio Humphrey as Hubert Horatio Hornblower. By their words, we know them. Ronald Reagan, in contrast, did not reveal himself through free speech. Mr. Reagan did not practice free speech. He practiced canned speech. He spoke mostly in anecdotes. He rarely gave press conferences. Nancy, his wife, however, did say some memorable things. Once she said of capital punishment, I think more people would be alive today if there was a death penalty. When Mr. Reagan did speak in public, he often emphasized the sound more than the words. He had a kind of comb and tissue paper voice. So we were never quite sure what he said when he talked about cutting back on school lunches or delimiting Head Start or invading Grenada. It all sounded like music. Free speech to Mr. Reagan was music. A melodic overtone that enabled him to do what he pleased, a form of charm. Thus, we were never quite sure if the verbal mistakes he made were truly mistakes or deliberate little fumbles designed to make him more endearing to us, like a dotty uncle. Still, he said some remarkable things. Returning from a trip to Latin America, he told us, you'd be surprised, they're all individual countries. Sure, we made mistakes, he once said, but point them out and we'll correct them. Let's not throw the baby out, though, with the dishes. I'm not sure why, but my very favorite thing he ever said was to the Lebanese foreign minister. It was when the Lebanese foreign minister was giving him a half-hour lecture on all the political factions in Lebanon. You may imagine what this sounded like. All the political factions in Lebanon and the Lebanese foreign minister giving the president of the United States a lecture on the subject. After he finished, Mr. Reagan approached the Lebanese foreign minister and said, you know, your nose looks just like Danny Thomas's. The music. Mark Twain knew the difference between sound and words in speech. Twain used to curse a lot, and his wife, Libby, wanted to cure him of the habit. So one morning, there was a minor mishap, a lost collar button or something, and Twain let fly with the usual barrage. Goddamn, rah, 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 rah. And Libby, thinking to show him how ugly such language sounded, repeated verbatim what her husband had said. Goddamn, rah, 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 rah. Twain stepped back, looked affectionately at his wife, and said, Libby, you know the words, but you don't know the tune. Reagan knew the tune. I must tell you, I'd originally intended not to include Vice President Dan Quayle in this discussion of free speech as revelation, because Mr. Quayle is not, after all, president. But since so many people seem concerned about Mr. Quayle becoming president, I thought I would allay their fears. Did your hearts beat faster when you saw Bush keel over with the flu in Japan? A couple of days ago, I read this in the papers, a quotation from Pat Buchanan. This was a rapprochement of sorts, or so it's described, with Mr. Quayle. Said Buchanan, "I've engaged in some repartee with Quayle." I'd like to hear that, wouldn't you? Get so little of a good repartee these days. "I've engaged in some repartee with Quayle," Mr. Buchanan told a New Hampshire radio audience. "But he's been a pretty good vice president. He's knowledgeable. I don't think people should be unduly alarmed at the prospect that he would be president." They're not. They're duly alarmed at the prospect that he should be president. "But put these worries aside. I've come to relieve your anxiety. You see, I've made a discovery about Mr. Quayle and his unusual way of speaking. I think Mr. Quayle is kidding when he says most of the things he says. Now, I've given the matter some thought, and I honestly believe that Mr. Quayle is, in his own subtle way, a student of the aforementioned Groucho Marx, a truly brilliant student of Groucho Marx. In other words, I think this whole Robert Redford comparison is a deliberate subterfuge. Moreover, I believe most of the hilarious things Mr. Quayle says may be read as an homage to Groucho. Well, see if you disagree. Here's what Mr. Quayle said upon returning from a trip to Hawaii. Hawaii has always been a very pivotal role in the Pacific. It is in the Pacific. It is part of the United States that is an island that is right here. Now, while you're thinking over that remark, here is Mr. Quayle again speaking about the toppling of the Berlin Wall. "I believe we are in an irreversible trend toward freedom, but that could change." Now, while you're mulling over both those comments, here is Groucho Marx in Duck Soup. Groucho, like Quayle, is also playing a major political figure. He is giving instructions to Margaret Dumont, of course, as he is about to leave for war. "After I leave tonight, will you ever forgive me? Here are the plans of war. They're as valuable as your life, and that's putting them pretty cheap. Watch them like a cat watches her kittens. Have you ever had kittens? No, of course not. You're too busy running around playing bridge. Can't you see what I'm trying to tell you? I love you." You see, it's perfect Dan Quayle. It has the same logic, the same structure, the same organizations as the two comments of Quayle I read, and of the one I'm about to read on the subject of national defense, which is the last of his quotations I'll read. Remember that Mr. Quayle is an expert on national defense. So here is the Vice President of the United States explaining our national defense. "Why wouldn't an enhanced deterrent, a more stable peace, a better prospect to denying the ones who enter conflict in the first place, to have a reduction of offensive systems and an introduction to defensive capability?" Exactly. If Dan would only add Groucho's last two lines to everything he said, none of us would worry when he became president. Can't you see what I'm trying to tell you? I love you. I hope you feel better now. I know I do. As for our current president, Mr. Bush, I confess he has been a great disappointment to me, especially lately. The quality of his free speech has deteriorated terribly, and with it is revealed a less attractive character. He speaks more coherently these days, only his thinking is worse. You remember, I remember in 1988, before and after the election, hardly a day would go by when Mr. Bush wouldn't say something wonderfully expansive, miraculously expansive. Now we go down, down, down. A few weeks ago, there was the following item in the New York Times. It was called Bush's Letter to the Jews. I felt entitled to read it. But listen, the measured phrasing, the diplomatic jargon, in answer to complaints that Bush was acting unfairly toward Israel, he wrote, "I have a great deal of respect for the exercise of free expression in the democratic process." And he also wrote, "I continue to value your thoughtful input and perspective." Listen to that. The democratic process. Thoughtful input and perspective. Dreadful. Dreadful. Where is the old George Bush who used to talk about going ballistic? And kicking a little ass. And Tension City. And the thing. Where is the old George Bush who explained the fiasco on his failure to appoint Secretary of Senator John Tower as Secretary of Defense? Thus, I have read that we made mistakes. I don't think, and if so, I would be glad to say so, but I don't know exactly. I can't think of a specific we might have done differently in this circumstance. You have to remember, one of the allegations was I took too long to send it up. But what we were trying to do was the same thing that overtook events once it got to the Hill. So that's what took the time to begin with. So maybe I made a mistake in just not going ahead. The old George Bush was a virtuoso. Where is the old George Bush who spoke in praise of Czechoslovakia's playwright President Václav Havel as, quote, being in jail and dying and living whatever for freedom? Or who described his own birthday party as good cake, good card, and not bad. Or who analyzed his own election in 1988 as saying, I think it no exaggeration to point out that the undecideds could go one way or the other. You see, the old George Bush revealed himself to be exactly who he was, a man without a center, just as his sentences had no center, no grounding. Now, a man without a center is no great shakes, but he's considerably better than a man whose center is destructive or mean. Frankly, I like George a lot better when he had no center than George with a center he seems to be developing. Where is the old George Bush who talked to reporters about the time his plane was shot down over the Pacific and he was forced to spend 3 days alone in icy waters? 3 days alone in icy waters. And the reporters asked him, what were you thinking about those 3 days? 3 days alone in icy waters. Cold, wet, floating between life and death. George Bush told the reporters he was thinking about the Constitution and the First Amendment. Come home, George. By the way, I hope you've not forgotten the subtitle of this lecture, Ashley Montana Goes Ashore in the Caicos. I am coming to it shortly. I only mention it now to aggravate your excitement. For the present, let me raise the following problem. If free speech reveals all the political chicanery and the cultural nonsense I've tried to describe, is free speech worth it? A reasonable question. Who knows? We must suppose that free speech is worth it. All we really know is that free speech is better than constrained speech. And for those who worry that things are getting out of hand once in a while, as we all do, there's always the recourse to taste, in case anyone cares to exert taste. We tend to forget that the expression of taste by individuals is not censorship. We have the right not to go to the art gallery and the right not to read the book. The expression of taste, as a matter of fact, is merely another expression of free speech. Of course, first one has to develop taste, sort of informed free speech, very rare. So free speech is personally creative. Free speech is an instrument of revelation. It reveals us not only as we are, but as we might become, as we might, under the best of circumstances, make ourselves. Free speech and the development of character. This is done most effectively, I believe, through the power of the written word. The written word, you remember that one. No visual aids for this part of the talk, and for an interlude, no fooling around. I was introduced to the power of the written word in the apartment house in which I grew up in New York. My mother was a junior high school English teacher, and she worked late in the afternoons, so I would go up and visit three elderly women who lived in the apartment directly above ours. They lived in a kind of antique splendor, these women, each doing her own thing, as none of them would have said. Miss Prescott was a librarian at Columbia. Miss Jordan, a novelist, at one time had been editor-in-chief of Harper's Bazaar magazine. Miss Cutler was a painter and a potter. Her forebears came over on the Mayflower. It was she, I think, who had the money. They lived in a dark museum of an apartment, with shields and swords on the walls, and ivory-carved elephants on the tables. I remember at the age of 5 thinking it noteworthy that people would carve elephants out of ivory, but I drew no conclusions. And they had framed coats of arms on the walls and a freestanding suit of armor in the hall. The women would read to me. They would read aloud to me from Dr. Doolittle and The Wind in the Willows and Jules Verne and Mark Twain's Tom Sawyer and eventually from Huckleberry Finn. At the age of 5, of course, I didn't understand Huckleberry Finn, but I could tell, as kids can, by watching the reactions of grown-ups, that this was a very important book, perhaps even a sacred book. It was always Miss Cutler of the Mayflower who read me Huckleberry Finn. And the dark museum of an apartment took on a mysterious silence whenever she came to the passage that I would like to honor with you tonight. You know this passage. It is where Huck is going to turn Jim, the runaway slave, in. Huck realizes he's disobeyed the law. He's afraid he'll go to hell for doing that. So he writes to Miss Watson, Jim's owner. And then he sets the letter aside. And then Huck thinks. I felt all good and washed clean of sin for the first time I had ever felt so in my life. And I knowed I could pray now. But I didn't do it straight off, but laid the paper down and sat there thinking. Thinking how good it was all this happened so, and how near I came to being lost and going to hell. And went on thinking, and got to thinking over our trip down the river. And I see Jim before me all the time, sometimes moonlight, sometimes storms. And we are floating along and talking and singing and laughing. But somehow I couldn't seem to strike no place to harden me against him, but only the other kind. I'd see him standing, my watch on top of his'n, so I could go on sleeping, and see him how glad he was when I came back out of the fog, and when I come to him again in the swamp up there where the feud was, and such like times, and would always call me honey, and pet me, and do everything he could think of for me, and how good he always was. And at last I struck the time that I saved him by telling the men we had smallpox aboard. And he was so grateful and said I was the best friend old Jim ever had in the world and the only one he's got now. And then I happened to look around and see that paper. It was a close place. I took it up and held it in my hands. I was a-trembling because I'd got to decide forever betwixt two things, and I knowed it. I studied a minute, sort of holding my breath, and then says to myself, all right then, I'll go to hell, and tore it up. I wanted to read that passage aloud to you as it was read to me, not only because it's a beautiful example of free speech, but because it tells us why free speech matters. I think it's important for us once in a while to remind one another why free speech matters. The passage says that all people are equal, and that the good and correct acts of judgment that we make are more important than the misjudgments of others, even when those misjudgments have the power of laws. It also says that we are obliged to go against the tide on or off a river if our moral consciences are going in the right direction and the tide is not. But most of all, that passage, which is an example of free speech, after all, an example of free expression, says that through language we are able to develop our own moral consciences on our own. Being born free, we are able to figure out who we are, unaided by anything but what is inside us, which seeks to come out. By working through his problem on his own, Huck did not only discover himself, he created himself. He created himself. That is what free speech allows. That is what it encourages. That is why it matters. And if the self one creates is decent enough, then free speech is put to very good use. If all of American literature were a body, a person, that passage from Huckleberry Finn would, I think, be the soul. Think of all the writers we love who have managed to translate that passage from Huckleberry Finn on their own before or after Huckleberry Finn was ever written. Robert Frost, writing of taking the road less traveled on. Emerson writing, "Whoso would be a man must be a nonconformist. Wherever a man comes, there comes revolution." Or Marion Moore writing of the mind as an enchanting thing, as an enchanted thing. "It's not a Herod's oath that will not change." Or Richard Wilbur writing of the mind as a bat in a cave, a bat in a cave that at its highest moment can correct the cave. Robert Lowell raging at the American people, "And the Republic summons Ike, the mausoleum in her heart." Carl Sandburg praising the popular will. "The people, yes." And Hemingway's Old Man in the Sea, an older Huck Finn on a wider body of water. And Fitzgerald gazing at Gatsby, gazing at Daisy's green light, struggling against his tide. And Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man fighting to be seen. And Zora Neale Hurston's Janie fighting to be seen as a free black woman, no easy feat. And Malamud's Fixer, and Updike's Rabbit, and Ann Tyler's Muriel, and Cooper's Leather Stocking, and Hester Prynne, and Billy Budd, and every fictional self-discovering American hero who never lived. Every American writer who is worth anything is aboard that raft of Huck and Jim. Their words are made on the raft, and they fly above the river. They fly above a country that is capable of tearing itself apart, and of immense cruelty, and immense wrong, and of straining against its own proper heart, and yet, from time to time, learns something about itself, and for the better, survives. The beauty of free speech when it is written is that it lasts. It may be handed down from raft to raft and from life to life and may wind up anywhere on the river. The words. The words are who we are and who we might become. The words. They may wind up in Lexington and Concord or Harper's Ferry or Gettysburg or Watts or Skokie or Bensonhurst, or Howard Beach, or Crown Heights. They may even wind up in the hands of an old woman whose forebears came over on the Mayflower, as she reads to a 5-year-old Jewish boy in a dark museum of an apartment in New York about a white kid from the South and the black man who loved him and whom he loved. So we sail on. Only someone equipped with a sublime sense of humor could have written anything as serious as Huckleberry Finn. It's why we love Twain, because he combined that seriousness with the humor. He had a sublime sense of humor, a sublime sense of fun, a kid's sense of fun. That's where I want to take us next, to fun, pure fun. There's so little fun in the air these days. Of course, there's so little seriousness, too, so it all balances out. Free speech and fun. I concentrate principally on the instrument of the telephone. I firmly believe that the telephone was only invented for fun. I call up an important person. I ask, the secretary asks, "Does he know what this is about?" I answer, "Not unless he's clairvoyant." I always answer that. Tickles me half to death. Or the secretary asked me to leave my name. I say, "Rosenblatt." She says, "Can you spell that?" "No, could you help me?" I call home collect, say it's a collect call from Roger. The operator says, "Thank you, Roger." Very informal, very chummy. They repeat anything you said. If I said it was a collect call from Jesus, they'd say, "Thank you, Jesus." My brother and I ran an elaborate telephone business a number of years ago. It was at the expense, perhaps literally, of Luchow's famous German restaurant. Some of you will remember Lu Chao's when it was located down on 14th Street. The heavy food, the heavy furniture, the Oompa band. Our folks used to take my brother and me to Lu Chao's on special occasions, even though my father said that the place was a Nazi hangout during the war. I always try to imagine what a Nazi hangout looked like. Nazis leaning up against the bar, just hanging out, reading Hitler's hang-ups. Anyway, my brother, who was 6 years my junior, though we're taken for twins. What are you smiling at? My brother, when he was in high school, received this wonderful gift of his own telephone, the number of which, miraculous good luck, was but one digit removed from that of Lu Chao's famous German restaurant. Naturally, people misdialed. At first, my brother was annoyed with the coincidence as calls for Lu Chao's and calls for my brother came in at a ratio of 20 to 1. So, eventually, tiring of the phrase wrong number, my brother began to take a few reservations. This was a cruel prank, to be sure, but partly justified in his and later in my own mind for our being on the receiving end of the calls. They were calling us, after all. Returning home from college one Christmas vacation, I was delighted to discover my brother's new enterprise, and I joined his restaurant business with all the high spirits of the season. Embellishing his practice of taking reservations straight, I would ask whenever someone called for a table for eight, for example, if he also wanted chairs with that. In no instance, and there were dozens, did the callers for reservations treat my question as odd. As long as they thought they had Lu Chao's on the phone, they had called after all, everything was acceptable. During spring vacation, we adorned our business with a touch of professionalism. Because of frequent requests for Lu Chao's head waiter, we learned that the man's name was Julius. My brother, for reasons of his own, converted Julius's name to Julio. And he would use this name whenever a call came in. I would answer the phone, transfer the call to Julio, who would do most of the talking in a Spanish-German accent, so difficult to penetrate that requests for tables and chairs often took 10 minutes. We then began to push things a bit, just to test the limits of human credulity. We asked people if they'd like to be seated in the Himmler room. Or if, instead of pancakes, they might like to try some of Lu Chao's new Luftwaffles. They're light as a Messerschmitt, we said. Perhaps they'd like to try Lu Chao's blitzes. These, we explained, were hundreds of blintzes dropped on one's plate from a great height. There were long pauses at the other end of the phone when we would ask such things. But the answers, when they arrived, were always polite and sincere. Once I asked a fellow if he'd mind taking a table for three rather than four. One of his company could dine elsewhere. They could all regroup for coffee. He declined, but he considered it. As these transactions continued over the summer, my brother and I grew somewhat ashamed at the havoc we assumed we were causing. We did not stop altogether, however, until the following Christmas vacation, when we started asking people if they would like to be seated on the roof, where we had set up a cold buffet. This was late December. The temperatures often fell below zero. Still, we had one or two takers for our rooftop seats, though that was not the event that finally caused us to give up the restaurant business. That event occurred on New Year's Day itself, when a delightful, sugar-voiced woman called in the morning merely to cancel her reservation for lunch. Julio was furious. How, he asked her, did she expect us to run a restaurant if people ran around canceling their reservations? No, madam, it was impossible. Under no circumstances could we accept her cancellation. When the woman apologized and changed her plans, we knew it was time to close shop. Free speech in America. The blessings of all this freedom. I only wish our speech were freer, that we might read and see things never said, never written before. I would like to read the cast list of Italian movie stars in a movie about something other than the mob. My Italian actor friends say these movies are great for jobs. I think they're stultifying. Why couldn't we have something different, something original? Francis Ford Coppola presents a Martin Scorsese production of an Al Martino film, starring Al Pacino, Robert De Niro, Dom DeLuise, Ida Lupino, Veal Scalapini, and Mama Celeste in The Lubavitcher Rabbi. Al Pacino is the Lubavitcher Rabbi. I'd love to hear Mayor Dinkins or any mayor in New York's history say, you know, New York really is more violent than other American cities. A lot more violent. I'm getting out of here. Of course, nobody ever talks that way, which is why free speech can never be free enough. Free speech is an instrument of continuous revelation. There's always something more to say, more words to spill. At least we Americans think so. Always something more. I walk into the city and listen. In every shop, at every street corner, every second of every day, someone says something astonishing, miraculous. If only it were possible to lift the roofs off the apartment houses, the conversations one would overhear, the sonorous pronouncements, the witty quips, the fatuous compliments, the insults, the anecdotes, things so amazing said in all seriousness, they would bring our eyes to tears. Or stroll into the heart of the Republic, eavesdrop on the chatter in the diners, the Sizzlers, the Bob's Big Boys, the Le Cirques, the Four Seasons, the International Houses of Pancakes. Pick up the discussions in the schoolrooms. Absorb the prayers in the church or synagogue of your choice. It's a treasure trove, I tell you, a horn of plenty. I do not exaggerate. Free speech in America, it's an embarrassment of riches, an embarrassment and riches. Where else but in this blessed land may one pick up a copy of Sports Illustrated? And merely because some editor has exercised his or her right of free speech, be transported to a world of inexpressible splendor. I refer to the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue, published nationally and celebrated for its annual devotion to swimsuits. On the cover of last year's swimsuit issue stands a large, tanned, gorgeous young woman in a white straw hat and a white bathing suit with a large gap in the back. Her lips are pink and puckered in a petulant yet perky pout. Her blonde hair, like strands of fine hay, falls across the bridge of her nose as if it were glued to it. Her arms are extended straight behind her. She appears to be shooing away a mob in pursuit. And the caption to all this, written in white lettering against the blue of the sea, reads, Ashley Montana goes ashore in the Caicos. Yes, we are here at last. Ashley Montana goes ashore in the Caicos. It may seem unusual that Miss Montana is said to be going ashore, having emerged from the sea, and is shown to be nonetheless nearly bone dry. Yet that is how it is. Ashley Montana goes ashore in the Caicos. From seven little words, freely conceived and conveyed, the reader is borne to the center of the American dream. I come now to the final wonder of free speech, that free speech allows us to dream. Free speech is an instrument of revelation. It reveals us through our dreams. We have so far discussed how free speech informs our culture, shapes our politics, encourages our development of character, arouses our capacity for fun. Now with this caption, Ashley Montana goes ashore in the Caicos, free speech carries us to a higher plane. How might that wonderful caption be made sensible? What story can I write? What story can I write to bring these words to life? We are aboard my sailing yacht, Ashley Montana and I. I, too, am named Ashley Montana. As is the yacht. All three of us are called Ashley Montana. We have just made love 4 times in the last 15 minutes. Ashley is pooped. I am full of pep and vim. She stretches herself out on the poop deck and veils her vague blue eyes behind the oversized lenses of her Porsche sunglasses. Pooped, I ask. Bored, she says. The word terrifies me. If Ashley is bored, she is bored with me. I know it's so. It was not so in the beginning when our love was young, or as Ashley put it, when our relationship was young. In those days, Ashley and I were new, everything new. We were modern life itself. How the days flew by. We would dine al fresco in those tiny cramped restaurants on Madison Avenue with the table spilling out into the middle of the sidewalk. We stared past each other and ordered water. How gaunt we looked. How pained. We read Vanity Fair magazine from cover to cover. Sometimes it took days. Yet we knew everything there was to know about Princess Di and Fergie and Jeremy Irons. Our heads swam with knowledge. We took up ceramics. We bought each other stuffed animals. We gave them names. We called them Ashley. We were invited to do benefits for serious diseases. We went. How we laughed. We threw each other surprise parties at which everyone made hilarious toasts and everyone brought hilarious gifts, and weren't we both surprised? Guests came dressed as their favorite form of aerobic exercise. Such fun guessing. We attended the lectures of John Bradshaw on public television. We discovered the child within us. We killed it. We watched another 30-part series on Masterpiece Theater on the continuing collapse of the British Empire. Britain was forced to give India back to India. We wept for weeks. We discussed our projects with other people. Other people discussed their projects with us. So many miniseries, so many docudramas, so many movies of the week, so many first novels. We had always wanted to write one. We bought land in Wyoming. We redid the kitchen. We could not use the apartment for a year. We renounced drugs, though neither of us had ever used any. Still, we admitted ourselves to the Betty Ford Clinic. Everyone said it was a beautiful gesture. It made the columns. We found ourselves. We lost ourselves. We found ourselves again. We lost ourselves again. Someone found ourselves for us and returned them, but demanded a reward. We learned how to be ourselves. We learned how to be other people. Other people learned how to be us. It was confusing. We had breakthroughs and breakdowns and breakfast and peaks. We reached critical mass. We were in a time warp. We experienced éclaircissements and rapprochements and schadenfreude and vertigo and Farfignugen and deja vu. We had the flu. We vowed to go somewhere completely different for the summer at first, but then in the end, when would we see our friends? We kissed each other, and everyone kissed us. We came on to each other. We had it all together. We got on with our lives. We told each other, go for it, it. We were there for each other, there. We refused to learn from history, and thus we were bound to repeat it. We were state of the art. We were on the cutting edge. We had our heads on straight. We had our priorities straight. We were super persons. We were bank presidents in the morning. We coached Little League in the afternoon. We cooked Coq au Vin at night. I don't know how we did it. We were caring persons. We cared for us. We saw Penn and Teller. We shopped at Dean and DeLuca. We called Jacoby and Myers. We knew Crabtree and Evelyn. Well, we knew Evelyn. We knew Cy Sims. We were educated consumers. We were his best customers. We had liposuction. We had hipposuction. We had rhinoplasty. We had elephantiasis. We lost 30 pounds on Ultra Slim Fast. We got gravely ill. We woke up and smelled the coffee. It was Folgers, mountain grown. We were laid back, we were uptight, we were ripped off, we were on a roll, we were in a rut, we were boss, we were fly, we were bitchin'. Didn't you just love us? We were fabulous. We got every joke that David Letterman made. We knew every arm gesture on Arsenio. We knew the names of every rock band on Saturday Night Live. We liked the way they dressed. We had brunch. We had shiitake mushrooms with buffalo wings and a tureen of carpaccio with a paillard of chicken. We fought for animal rights. We opposed capital punishment. We opposed capital punishment for animals. A pussycat was electrocuted in Texas. A serial killer. Mice, mostly. We held a vigil. We were above the law. We were below the fold. We were beyond the pale. We were under a great deal of pressure. We were around the block. We were over the hill. We were beside ourselves. We were beneath contempt. We were into health foods. We were into yoga. We were into prepositions. We were Eurocentric. We were Eurotrash. We interfaced. We faded in. We faded out. We cut to the chase. Someone picked up our option. We did construction work. We did deconstruction work. Our telephone answering machine left exceptionally clever messages. We received calls from cars, from airplanes, from briefcases. We received a life call from Mrs. Fletcher. I've fallen and I can't get up. We let her lie there. We had eyeglasses made in 1 hour. We lost contact. We began to bicker. I said, let's stick with AT&T. She said, let's switch to Sprint. I said, Certz is a candy mint. She said, Certz is a breath mint. I said, it looks like a pump. She says, feels like a sneaker. I said, Ed McMahon is a slave to Johnny. She said, Ed McMahon is a star in his own right. Could we both be right? We made up. We vowed to have no more big dinner parties. We had a good life. We had a good day. We had a good one. And then suddenly it was gone, all gone. Now everything I say to Ashley, she finds boring. I raise the subject of politics, boring, she says. I show her my framed photograph of Treasury Secretary Nicholas Brady. Boring, she says. The world of current events, which enchants me completely, is as nothing to Ashley. Verbal nuances which have me mesmerized hold her not. Books, television, the antics of public figures, all of which have me excited, set her to yawning. I tried to bring back the old days. I sang her Macho Man. She turned away. I sang her Kumbaya. She said she never heard of it. Still, I worship the sea she sails on. Now, on our boat, the Ashley Montana, I say to her, Ashley Montana, Ashley, let's find a new island for us. We had already been to many such islands. Several were on the Perillo tours. All had failed to seize Ashley's imagination, an elusive thing, to be sure. Still, the suggestion perks her up. Aruba, I suggest. She shakes her head, no. Anguilla, I offer. She rolls her eyes skyward. St. Bart's, St. Kitts, St. Croix. Not a nod. How about, she suggests, Porto San. I explain to her that Porto San is not an island. How about, she suggests again, the Caicos. The Caicos, I say. The Caicos. Never heard of them. Never heard of them, says Ashley. Never heard of the Caicos. She explodes in laughter so shrill it scatters the fish. Ashley, Ashley, she says, everyone has heard of the Caicos. The Caicos are it. Jerry Zipkin goes there. Oscar de la Renta is there right now. Imelda Marcos, all the best people. If you've never heard of the Caicos, she says, what's the point, I'd like to know, of us going on? They were the words I had trembled to hear. Shamelessly, I beg her to stay with me, but I can see she is ready to jump ship. It was plain from the start. She has her world, I mine. Go, I tell her, but stay dry. Goodbye, Ashley, she says as she jumps overboard, the water beating and immediately evaporating on her swimsuit as she glides through the sea. Soon she is far away. I am all alone. I turn my yacht about and sail north. Thank you. putting on my tape of Zamfir. I console myself by listening to the unbeatable pan flutist flautist as he plays I Dreamed a Dream. Images that fortify my life come rushing back to me. Everyone is present. David Brinkley and Ronald Reagan, George Wallace and Jimmy Carter, Alexander Haig and Zbig and Ivana and Al Sharpton and Alan Dershowitz, George Bush, Richard Nixon, Cher and Nancy and Dave Del Dotto and Dan Quayle and Senator Strom Thurmond and John Sununu and the Devil and Miss Jones and the Christian Children's Fund and Xanadu, school boards and war criminals, mayors and movie stars, all sitting at a table in Luschau's in December on the roof without chairs. I embrace them all in my heart, which is brimming over with love and melancholy and gratitude. That above all, boundless gratitude. While in the distance, with the sun full upon the sea and the air as free as you and I, as free as speech itself, Ashley Montana goes ashore in the Cape.